show how you, what I'm talking about, and also how you can check that. I'll use this Lie-Nielsen chisel plane up here. So twist would be, you know, a rotation of that sole along the length of the body. And you can get down like this and try and eyeball it, but it's hard for your eye to pick up if there's really any sort of a twist of the body. You can use this technique where you take two pieces of wood or steel or plastic that have sides that are perfectly parallel to each other. Right? And lay them on the plane like so. And then sight down with two sticks. And because they are basically an extension of this surface, they will exacerbate any sort of wind or twist in the sole of the plane. They're called winding sticks. And interestingly, you can do that same thing when you're checking the flatness of the board. Lay the board on a table, put your winding sticks on, and sight down the winding sticks. And it gives you a very accurate read on how flat the board is. Alright, so that's one thing you want to make sure does not exist. If there is a twist, then we need to take that out of the plane. Looking back at this one, in my opinion, the places that are most important to be flat or in plane with each other are the heel of the plane, the toe of the plane, and this area right in front of the throat. Right? It could be scalloped here and scalloped here. In fact, a lot of Japanese plane makers and users actually create that wave effect in the plane, where this is in plane, this is in plane, this is in plane, and then this area is slightly concave. The advantage to that is just that it would reduce the friction between the sole of the plane and the wood, so theoretically make it a little bit easier to plane. Obviously, you want these two parts to be flat and in plane with each other to help describe a flat surface on the wood. You want this to be in the same plane, right here in front of the throat of the plane, because it is critical for pushing the wood down as you're planing and preventing it from chipping and tearing out as you're planing. So as you're working through the plane iron is levering the wood up. Right? And if there's a big space, open space in front of the plane iron, that wood will just sort of break out in advance of the cutting action of the plane iron. So that having that area flat right in front of the throat keeps the wood compressed and down so that it doesn't just tear out and it waits to be sliced by the plane iron. If you find that your plane is very unflat, you need to flatten it, the sole. I have several techniques here. You can purchase many different things that are flat. One of the least expensive and most attainable is just a piece of glass. So you want to get a piece of tempered glass so that if it breaks, you don't have to cut it. And you can just take the plane iron. What I have here is 220 grit wet dry sandpaper. You definitely want to do this with water present, get that nice and wet, and then just slide the sole of the plane iron around on it. And you can, if you do that for a few minutes, that will give you a pretty accurate read on how flat the sole is and whether you need to do any more work. Again, you want to have it in plane, these three points, the toe, this area right in front of the throat, and the heel in plane with each other. And I don't know if you can see from where you're sitting, but I can see that the sandpaper was in fact rubbing right here. A little bit here and here, so it's not necessarily perfectly flat all the way across this area. It's also rubbing behind the throat, which is fine, and then rubbing all the way back here. This particular plane is a bedrock number four, a bailey number four, and it has these corrugations in the sole that are, again, supposed to reduce friction. I don't really notice a significant difference when I'm working with this plane compared to another number four edge plane. But that's an important thing. So this is one way of flattening it. Wet-dry sandpaper on a piece of glass. You can purchase something a little more elaborate. This is something that we sell here, actually. It's perhaps a little more conducive to plane flattening just because of the length, but it is a piece of glass that's laminated to a piece of wood, and it comes with these wet-dry sandpapers with adhesive on the back to hold it in place. You can also purchase granite that has been machined very flat. And there are a number of different lapping plates that you can purchase that are intended for the same purpose. The glass is quite expensive and available, and it does a nice job getting that nice and flat. Alright, another area that wants to be flat to avoid chatter and so on is this part of the plane, which is called the frog. So this whole apparatus that holds the plane iron and cap iron and so on can be removed from the plane body. There are two screws right here, and the whole frog comes right out. You want this surface to be very flat. In fact, that is the sign of a good plane maker. Certainly the Lie-Nielsen planes come nice and flat all the way along the length of the frog so that the iron gets bedded firmly and is held stiffly in place. You want a good contact all the way up and down the frog, between the frog and the backside of the plane iron. That's what will hold it firmly in place and prevent it from chattering as you're cutting the wood. So what I like to do is actually remove the frog. Now, you can probably see from where you're sitting how shiny this frog is on this relatively old Bailey. I've taken the frog out, and you can see that this part here is still rusty. That's because this is riveted in place. Okay? This is the lever that allows you to adjust the plane iron laterally to make sure that what pokes through on the underside is parallel to the flatness of the sole. That doesn't come out. And then this piece here interfaces with the backside of the plane iron and moves the blade up and down. That could be removed on some planes, but on this one again it would require tapping a little pin out. So I just leave that all in place, take the frog out. This screw removes, screws right out, and I do the same thing. Put it right on the glass so you can see I'm not able to hit this area here because that would require grinding these two parts. I'm able to get this whole frog nice and flat on a piece of glass. And I do the same thing to the back side of the plane iron. Okay, so you remove the cap iron from the plane iron, again put that flat on the glass and just get it nice and flat. So the two surfaces mate nicely. This is the briefly about the chip breaker. So if you hold this like this, you can see that at the very end of the chip breaker, there's a little bit of a curve. It comes away from the plane, a little bit deeper into the frog. Pardon me, backing that screw out from, screwing it in. Screwing the screw in a little bit further, obviously, we'll make this a little bit tighter. The lever pushes this little piece down against the plane. And in turn, that pushes against the screw, the other side of the screw. All right. All of those things that I've discussed so far are important, especially if they are way out of whack. So if you have a sole that is truly out of flat, or your frog surface is very rough, and a lot of mass-produced planes have a terrible surface here. It's very unflat, or very irregular, and those irregularities mean that the iron is not going to bend well. It's not going to be firmly seated against the frog. And you'll tend to have a plane that just chatters no matter what you do. But generally, it needs to be pretty bad in order for correcting those things to have a significant improvement on the performance of the plane. Yes?
Once you've done all those things, are you going to need to do them again sometime?
Not particularly unless the plane gets very rusted. So if you get a really pitted surface on the frog, and unfortunately it's easy for that to happen. If it gets wet and then you put it in your toolbox for a while, the water gets trapped in the plane iron and the frog, for instance. So I like to keep everything oiled. This all has a layer of oil on it. And the oil that I like to use is 15W camellia oil. Because it doesn't stain the wood. You can actually get little spray bottles of it and spray all of the steel surfaces. Steel is porous, so it sinks in and prevents corrosion. All right. What I consider to be the most important thing affecting the performance of the plane is the sharpness of the iron. So that is where I spend the vast majority of my time when I'm tooling a plane. And even the Lie-Nielsen planes do not come what I would consider particularly sharp.